Josie was an Inuit rights activist. That was the number one thing that drove Josie. Josie is a kind of a person that you don't forget. Whether you were with Inuit political arenas or you were with the Canadian Broadcasting Brass, they always called him brilliant. What a brilliant person that man is. And it's because of his great way of communicating and always with the Inuit perspective behind him.
Josie was a huge leader and a champion of Inuit in all that he did. As a political leader, especially at ITK, he worked to reposition Inuit in the conversations about Indigenous peoples. Also, in the face of a majority of First Nations and Métis voices at the national level, Inuit often were lost, and there wasn't a specific focus on Inuit. And so Josie made the case to political leaders for Inuit specificity in federal consideration of Indigenous peoples, but also told the Inuit history in a way that very few other political leaders had previously.
Because he was very much into his culture, and everything that he did was within his culture. When he met prime ministers or other big leaders from the country, he met them as an Inuit and not as anybody else. And I know that the leaders really appreciated that, because they realized just how so much that the Inuit had to offer to the rest of Canada. And he's the one, as we know, came out with Canadian First and First Canadian. The expression First Canadians, Canadians First came out at a perfect timing when Canadians were really starting to question Inuit and Aboriginals. Are you Canadian or are you something else? That kept coming out during the, especially after the First Minister's Conferences in 1982, when it was entrenched that Inuit had constitutional rights, and Section 35 was entrenched to recognize that. So we were thinking of how do we express ourselves that we're very proud Canadians, but you cannot remove us from being an Aboriginal. Until Josie thought of the one line, like, how brilliant can you be to think that up during the Charlottetown Accord? He said what we all were thinking, but didn't know how to say it.
He just left an indelible footprint on the political space nationally and also across Inuit Nunavut. So his political legacy is something that I think about most often, and think of the gains that he made in relation to Inuktitut, in relation to Inuit rights, but then also in relation to how Canadians see Inuit.
And he was also a linguist. He worked so hard all his life to elevate the protection of Inuktitut, our language, and our culture. He was so knowledgeable on it that I could sit with Josie with elders, and he wouldn't be any less than they were. The elders would really enjoy this person. And we really got to know each other when we went to a residential school in 1964 in Churchill, Manitoba. While we were in Churchill, what got Josie and I so close together as well is that we started a rock band. The name of our band was the Harpoons. And it's been said that we were the very first Eskimo rock band of the time. I say Eskimo because we use that term later on in years when we'd meet up. Of course, I'd take the guitar and he'd take his harmonica, and we would sing songs. And the song that he used to really like in singing with me was When God Comes and Gathers His Jewels. When God comes and gathers his jewels. He really sang that well. And I think it, I thought about that when he passed on, and I think I'd like to sing that with him one more time. All the treasures of diamonds and gold, I'll be up there when the weather's so fair.
When God comes and gathers his jewels.